Hello everyone, I welcome you all in the course of high voltage engineering. So in the first lecture we have already discussed that what are the various applications of high voltage engineering, means why we are reading this subject, what are the various applications, that what is high voltage and what is its various applications in the field of agriculture, medical, transportation, and of course in the power industry. So we have seen the various applications in various fields why we are studying this subject. So without making any further delay, we will see today's topic, that historical development of high voltage power system. So to understand the concept of high voltage engineering deeply, we will see the historical development took place all across the world, year by year or decade by decade. So contents of this presentation, these are the contents of the presentation, that we will see first what is the general layout of power system, how first electric power system is developed, when it is developed, what is the impact of invention of motor, transformer, AC transmission line, when polyphase system has been developed. So we will see the historical background of evolution of electrical power system. Then we will see the standardization of frequency. So many students are asking that sometimes in the class, that why frequency is not 25 hertz, why not 60 hertz, why not 75 hertz. So this all question we will see in this particular session. We will see the standardization of transmission voltage, why the transmission voltage is like 11 kV, 33 kV, 66 kV, 132 kV, and so on. We will see the development of first modern commercial HVDC transmission system. Then we will see the structure of power system, generation, transmission, and distribution. So this is the general layout of power system. This is the simplest way of representing the electrical power system. So here this black one is representing the generation. So first there will be generation of power, then transmission of power, then there will be distribution of power. So this is the basic structure of electrical power system. So generation is generally up to 30 kV. So from generation end, we are stepping up it for transmitting the power. So this transmission of power will be at high voltage. So as per the need of transmission, that what amount of power we are going to transmit, what is the distance of power transmission. So we are selecting the level of voltages for transmission, like 220 kV, 400 kV, 765 kV, etc. And then at the consumer end, again we are reducing the voltage by step down transformer, like big consumer will be provided at sub transmission level only at 33 kV, and rest we are converting to first 33 to 11 kV, then 11 kV to 415 volt three phase. So in three phase we are distributing the loads equally to balance the electrical load. So this is the simplest structure of electrical power system, starting from generation, transmission and distribution. So basically this generation is in high voltage, and this transmission, this distribution, sorry, this distribution is also in high voltage, that 33 kV, 11 kV, and at distribution end again we are converting to the 11 kV to 0.415 kV for three phase distribution. So basically this region is the high voltage region. So this is the simplest diagram of a power system, but it is not this much simple. There are so many other devices are there, like lightning arrester, circuit breaker, cables, transformers, so many substations will be there. So what is the general characteristics of modern power system? The purpose of general characteristics of modern power system is to provide general description of electrical power system, know the basic characteristics of and structure of modern power system, and to know the control requirement. So we will start with the evolution of electrical power system. So we will see the main milestone of electrical power system achieved all across the world. So in 1870, the commercial use of electricity began, and at that time people are using only arc lamps. These kind of arc lamps were used for lighting, actually they are using for street light also. This type of lamps were used, and at that time there is a great American inventor, that Thomas Alva Edison. Actually he is not only the scientist inventor, but he is also a good businessman at that time. So Edison, this is the first bulb, Edison first bulb. They have demonstrated in December 1879, and he got a patent in 1880 based on the development of electrical bulbs. So Thomas Alva Edison have so many that development in the fields of electrical power generation, mass communication, sound recording and motion pictures. So he also established first industry, first research industry, and holding 1093 US patents. So this is the first electrical power system developed by Thomas Alva Edison in the strict coil strict station of the New York City. So this was a completely DC system. Here generation will be here generation was in DC, and transmission and distribution, everything was in DC. So this is not actually the transmission, this is just for connecting the load from the generator. So it was only in the 1.5 kilometer radius area. So first time they have used steam engine driven DC generator, which supply 59 customers only for lighting purpose. So they have used at that time 110 volt through underground cable system. So this was the first power system. So by looking Thomas Edison's power plant, many similar systems were in operation throughout the world. So they start developing their own power system. 1882 is a main milestone that Thomas Alva Edison shows in the US the way of distributing the power. In 1884, with the development of motor by Frank Spark, so he developed a motor in 1884. So with the development of motor, we all know that most of the industry are working on DC motor only. So this was the beginning of what would develop into one of the largest industries in the world. So Spark was also an American naval officer and inventor who contributed to the development of electric motors, electric railways and electric elevators. So this was the spark motor developed in 1890. In 1886, there was a need of distributing power for long distances, but in DC there was a problem there. The transmission losses were too high because of low voltage, so voltage can't be stepped up at that time. Also, there was a problem in DC that at that time so many machines they are using in the industry, and many machines required different voltage level, and getting different voltage level was not possible in DC at that time. So this was a great problem at that time. And second, that transmission of power for longer distance is not possible due to the limitations of enhancement of voltage level. Then the development of transformer and AC transmission by L. Gallard and J.D. Gibbs led to the development of AC electric power system in the US. In 1886, William Stanley developed and tested commercial practical transformer and AC distribution system. So this is the Stanley transformer prototype developed in 1885. Then this is the man behind the today's electrical AC power system used all across the world, Nikola Tesla. So Nikola Tesla, the first AC transmission line in North America was put into the operation, and it was a single phase line transmitting power of 4000 volt over a distance of 21 kilometer. Nikola Tesla also developed a polyphase system. So in 1888, Nikola Tesla has several patents on the AC motor, generator and transformers. So there is a history between Nikola Tesla and Thomas Alva Edison. So Thomas Alva Edison was not only the inventor, but he is also a great businessman. So Thomas Alva Edison, generating power in DC, transmitting in DC and distributing in DC. So he was always favoring that DC system. Nikola Tesla, he were working first time in their Thomas Alva Edison company, and Edison given so many tasks to Nikola Tesla to find the DC system that develop more reliable electrical machines. So in DC, but Nikola Tesla was always working for AC. He knows the limitations of DC system. Nikola Tesla developed a polyphase system. And due to at that time, due to some controversy between Nikola Tesla and Edison, they both got separated, and Nikola Tesla opened their own company with the help of some investors, and Edison favored DC and Nikola Tesla favored AC. So at that time, so many histories there that Nikola Tesla developed AC motor, induction motor, and Nikola Tesla was also working on wireless power transmission at that time only. And by keeping that in mind, he has also developed that Tesla coil. So it is Tesla coil is used to generate very high voltage. So coming to the today's topic only, we will stick on the high voltage region. So in 1890, there was a controversy between Edison and Westinghouse, who supported AC, and Edison that favored DC, and Thomas Alva Edison, which working with Westinghouse, favored AC. So obviously, that AC won, that due to several advantage of AC. The main advantage is that we can change the voltage level very easily with the use of transformer in the system. So generation was in high voltage, then transmission can be at any level of voltage with the help of transmission transformer. So AC is at more advantages than DC. Also generation as well as consumption. So generation was in AC with the AC generator. So if we will compare AC generator and DC generator, AC generator has also so many advantage with the DC generator, because in DC generator the main problem is that commutator. So commutator we have to and also that problem of collecting the current. So at commutator inside the machine, whether it will be AC or DC, that conversion takes place in AC only. But in case of DC generator or a DC motor, we need extra things, that is the commutator. So which will convert AC induced in EMF to DC and vice versa. So AC generators are much simpler than DC generator. Same way AC motors are much simpler than DC motors. So both generation, transmission at high voltage, as well as distribution at the load end, there are AC motors. So this all makes AC system more advantageous compared to the DC system. So in 1893, the first three-phase line in North America went into operation. It was 12-kilometer line in South California. So then there was a problem at that time. In the entire world, their area-wise, they are developing their own power system. They are using their own voltage level, own frequency, not interconnected with the other power system. So many different frequency were in use. Some region they are using 25 hertz. Some region they have used 50 hertz, 60, 125, and 133 hertz. So obviously this posed a problem for interconnections. Why? We all know that whenever we want to connect to power system, AC power system, that frequency must be same, voltage level must be same, and phase sequence must be same. these are the criteria for connecting to power system, AC power system. So they are operating with a different frequency level. So suppose in some region they are generating more power and using less power, so they want to sell the power to the another region by interconnecting their power system. So that was not possible with various frequencies. So 50 and 60 hertz frequency was the optimum frequency, because frequency is related to the losses. We know in the machine that frequency is proportional to the iron loss, both eddy current loss and hysteresis loss. So as the frequency will increase, this both losses will increase, and ultimately iron loss will get increased. So we can't operate at very high frequency. Also, skin effect is also one of the one region. So we can see what is skin effect. This is shown in this figure. The skin effect causes the effective resistance of the conductor to increase at higher frequency with the skin depth is smaller. So this is the demonstration of AC system. So reducing the effective cross section of the conductor. So here we can see that what is the impact of skin effect in AC as well as DC conductor. So this is the DC conductor, this is the AC, and this is the AC at a higher frequency. So as the frequency is increasing, that resistance are getting increased. So skin effect is high for 60 hertz. So increase in resistance is more for 60 hertz compared to 50 hertz, but it is very small. Also, if you will see the temperature region, that Indian temperature is more compared to the other countries, the US. So that as the temperature increases, also resistance increases. So here the Indian power supply rule of India is 220 to 250 volt and 50 hertz. The major region is the ambient temperature is higher, and the high frequency can heat up wiring etc. So what is the advantage of 50 hertz compared to the 60 hertz? So in 50 hertz, first that we have already discussed that losses, iron loss ED and hysteresis loss will be less compared to the 60 hertz. It and if losses will be less, it will provide a more efficient machine. So better machine design, better torque due to lower skin effect, and easy conversion. So actually, selection of frequency is a concept of design. That at 50 hertz in India there is a single phase 230 volt, and in at 60 hertz in US it is 110 volt. 110 volt is quite safer than 230 volt. US is more preferring the safety over the economy. So we know that as the voltage level will be increased, again same concept will be there, that current rating will get reduced for the same power rating. So if current rating get reduced, that losses will get reduced, and heating will be less in all the devices also. So it will be more economical to operate at 50 hertz compared to 60 hertz. But if we will see from the safety point of view, 110 volt will be more safer than the 230 volt. So these are the impact of the frequency. So we are not using very less frequency like 25 hertz, 33 hertz, and because at that voltage level will be also very high, and we are not using very high frequency like 133 hertz and 75 hertz, so that losses will be very high. So US, Canada, and many other countries are using 60 hertz. India, Europe, and other countries using 50 hertz. So this was the standardization of frequency and what is the impact of frequency in the power system. Next, up to that point, every inventor knows that as we are increasing the level of voltage, that current rating will get reduced and losses of the transmission losses will get reduced. So they keep on working on increasing the transmission voltage. So in early AC system used 12, 44 and 60 kV line to line. This rose to 165 kV in 1922, 220 kV in 1923. So this is the voltage level used anywhere all across the world. 287 kV in 1935, 330 kV in 1953, and 500 kV in 1965. So next, hydro Quebec energized its first 735 kV in 1966, and 765 kV was introduced in the United States of America in 1969. So to avoid the unlimited number of voltages, the industry has standardized the voltage level. The standards are 115, 138, 161 and 230 kilovolt for the high voltage class, and 345, 500 and 765 kV for extra high voltage classes, and more than that was the ultra high voltage classes. So this is the world scenario. If we will see in the Indian context, that high voltage lines are like 33 kV, 66 kV, 132 kV and 220 kV. For extra high voltage, there are two lines, generally 400 kV and 765 kV, and more than that comes under the category of ultra high voltage. So sometimes students are asking, sir, why this voltage level is in the multiple of 11, looking like 11, 33, 66, 132. So it's nothing like that. It is not the multiple of 11 kV. If you will see that we have the voltage level of 400 and 765 kV also, which is not the multiple of 11. Also upcoming, that voltage level 1000 kV and 1200 kV also we are planning. That is also not the multiple of 11. It is just because of that replication of design is simple, and it is nothing to do with the form factor. That conversion is simple, design of transformer is simple. So this is the standardized of standardization of voltage as well as frequency. Then in 1950 there was a development of mercury arc valve. So with the development of this mercury arc valve, again there was a controversy where we should use HVDC or HVAC. So with the development of mercury arc valve, it becomes very easy to convert from AC to DC and DC to AC with the converters. So from economical point of view, if there is a need of transmission bulk amount of power for longer distance, it is better to use HVDC compared to HVAC. So we have to do the economical analysis. Roughly, if we want to see that if we want to transmit power more than 500 cable, 500 kilometer for the overhead transmission line, and less than 50 kilometer for underground or submarine cables, we should prefer HVDC. So HVDC have also so many other advantages compared to the HVAC, that this comparison we will see in the coming lecture in detail. But for the time being, that HVDC provides asynchronous link also, means two power system operating at different frequency can be connected in the HVDC, which is not possible in the HVAC system. So evolution of electrical power system continued in this manner. In 1954, first modern commercial application of HVDC transmission occurred in 1954 in the Swedish mainland, between Swedish mainland and the island of Gotland, were connected by 96 kilometer submarine cables. So with the advent of thyristor valve converter, even it becomes more attractive HVDC transmission. So this is the early thyristor valve, looking like something like this. So in 1972, the first application of HVDC system using thyristor valve was at L River in 1972. It was a back-to-back scheme providing an asynchronous tie between the power system of Quebec and New Brunswick. So this is the thyristor valve at the HVDC substation for converting that HVDC to HVAC for distribution purpose. With the cost and size of conversion equipment decreasing and the reliability increasing, there has been a steady increase in the use of HVDC transmission throughout the world due to several advantages. Power control also becomes power transfer control also becomes very easier in the HVDC compared to the HVAC. So this is all about the historical development of electrical power system. So we have seen that the development of voltage levels year by year, decade by decade throughout the world. So it make the today's modern power system. So next, that power system overall consists of only three main part. We can divide the power system, that is generation, transmission and distribution. So generation, most of the power, that 60 to 70% power is generated from the thermal power plant. So synchronous machine is used to generate electrical energy from mechanical energy. So this is the synchronous generator. So generator voltage are usually range from 11 to 35 kV. So electrical power system comprised of three phase AC system operating essentially at constant voltage. So first will be the generation system, then there will be transmission. So we have seen that generation voltage 11 to 35 kV, so which is stepped up with the help of transformer for transmission transmission of power at reduced loss. So transmission will be at very high voltage, extra high voltage, ultra high voltage. So as per the need, how much power we want to transmit and what is the distance of transmission. So there will be step up transformer to step up the voltage, and power will be transmitted via transmission line. So then at the receiving, there will be sub transmission system. So sub transmission system will provide the power to the large industry at 66 kV and 33 kV. Then at the end, there will be power distribution system. So power distribution system will look like this. So here we have shown that three phase system is there. So distribution system represents the final stage of the transfer of power at the individual customers. So at 11 kV, there will be again a transformer to convert 11 kV to 0.415 kV three phase, and then three phase load will be connected like this, and this and small industry will be connected at this primary distribution. system. Then there will be secondary distribution system. Secondary distribution system means 11 to 0.415 kV. That conversion transformer will be there. So this is a delta star transformer. So at the star end, again at each phase, we are getting 230 volt, and loads were connected at the distribution end. Say for example that a 60 kilowatt load is there, so 20 kilowatt will be given at each phase to balance the load. Otherwise there will be a problem of circulating current, and more voltage fluctuations will be there, quality of power will get reduced. So that balancing of load will be done at this distribution side. So this is the overall structure of power system. This is the single line diagram of power system. So there will be generating station first. So this is the symbol of generator. So first generation will be in the range of 11 kV to 33 kV or 33 kV, so as per the available rating of the generator. Then there will be step up transformer for transmission purpose, 11 kV to 220 kV, and there will be high voltage transmission. Then there will be step down transformer at the receiving station, so 220 kV to 33 kV. So at this point also that bigger consumer can be connected. So then there will be secondary transmission that 33 kV to 6.6 kV. So at this point large factories and industries can be connected, and then 6.6 kV to 400 volt three phase or 230 volt single phase will be there. So this will be the distribution. So generation, transmission and distribution, this completes the structure of power system. I hope all of you have understood the historical background of electrical power system. So with this we came to the end of today's lecture. So these are some references students may refer to understand the power system. So power system stability and control, P.S. Kundur book. So in the first chapter, it is in the introduction, it is given the all the history of the power system. I have referred from there, and some books they can refer. And these are the websites, Ministry of Power, Central Electricity, National Power Portal, allaboutcircuits.com, and Edison Tech Center. So these are some references students may refer to understand more clearly. So for any query, students may email on this email ID. Thank you everyone.